This is the world's oldest surviving steam engine. I'm Darren, and this is the Industrial Revolution. But is it the world's oldest surviving steam engine? And, well, is it a steam engine at all? You might remember this engine. This is a 1760 Newcomen engine from an earlier video. And so people questioned, is it a steam engine or is it an atmospheric engine? And some others questioned, is it really the oldest? Well, those are some good questions, and we're going to take a look at those in this video and hopefully answer those for you. So the first question is, what actually is a steam engine and what actually is an atmospheric engine? And I think the easiest way to answer that is to look at a completely different engine. So this is Hero's engine. At the time, the inventor of this engine, Hero, sometimes called Heron, from Alexandria, Egypt, 1st century BC, he actually referred to it as the aeolipile. Now, if we take a look at it, it doesn't look much like an engine today. But what we have, the bottom, we have a boiler. We have pipes running up the side to a ball. That ball has two jets that come out of it at opposite angles. And you light a fire under the boiler, steam comes up both of the pipes into the ball. The ball then fills with steam, and with those two pipes coming out at opposite angles, it spins the ball. And it works. We know this was built, and it was a great demonstration of steam power. Question is this actually steam powered? Well, yeah, you're putting steam into it. Something's happening. So definitely this is steam powered. Next question is it an engine? And that's where you get a little bit more complexity into the question, I guess. It does do something, and it's called Hero's engine. But is it actually an engine? And I would say probably not. And the issue is, an engine has to do some kind of useful work on something external to itself. And Hero's aeolipile, even though it's called Hero's engine, never really did any useful work. Could it have done useful work? Unfortunately, probably not. The boiler technology just was not there. At the time, you were limited to very, very low pressures. Even in Newcomen's time, anything over an atmosphere pressure, anything over about 15 psi, just wasn't doable. And you know, certainly in the 1st century AD, they did not have the technology to produce either sufficient volume of low-pressure steam or a sufficiently high pressure of steam to actually do any useful work on anything external to itself. So this was a great invention. Future steam engineers used it as a demonstrating tool. In fact, I think I may have seen it in a physics class. But I wouldn't call this an engine. So to figure out what actually constitutes a steam engine, let's take a look at something newer, like this nice modern Model T engine here. And here at the Henry Ford Museum, they have a Model T all exploded for us so we can actually take a good look at it. So the engine here, we know is a gasoline-powered engine. I don't think anyone's going to question it's a gasoline engine. You put gasoline into it, and magic happens, and you get work out of it. So that's a requirement for an engine, is that you put in some kind of energy, whether that's gasoline or steam or whatever. Magic happens. And then you get work out. In this case, it turns a drive shaft for us. So if you compare that to like Hero's device in Alexandria, you put steam into it, but it didn't actually produce any usable work. And since it didn't produce any usable work, probably didn't qualify as an engine. This does qualify as an engine. The Watt Newcomen engines, those also obviously qualify as engines. Here we put steam into it,
here we put gasoline into it and work happens. There we put steam into it. Here's a gasoline engine. Those are steam engines. So here's a so-called engine. Great demonstration of steam's power. Not an engine.
Okay, so here's the next contender for the steam engine title. First steam engine title. This was built in 1606 in Spain, and we know it was actually built. It was built by, excuse the pronunciation, Jerónimo de Ayanz y Beaumont. This was more than 100 years before the Newcomen engine. So clearly that puts it in contention for the world's first steam engine. And there's some problems with this one. There is a huge amount of misinformation about this and how it worked and if it worked. And a lot of that misinformation is where we get the idea that maybe this was actually the first steam engine, when maybe it wasn't. So most of that misinformation comes from stories that were in the media. And these were written by people who weren't scientists, they weren't engineers, they weren't physicists, and they just really didn't understand the concept. So if you have information about this, if you have better information than what I ran across, please do put it down in the comments and share that with everyone. The best article I found was written by Anton Howes, and I'm putting a link to that in the description. And again, if you have better information, please share it. But what we have here is a pump that... Okay, so first piece of misinformation is a vacuum pump. And was this actually a vacuum pump? Well, I think that came about because there's a height limit. It could only pump water up about 30 feet. And pretty much everybody agrees it had that limitation. It could only pump up about 30 feet. And if you know about physics and you know about suction, you know about all that, you know that you can generate vacuum and you can pull water up about 30 feet. So if you're condensing steam, that's how high you can go. The drawings I found, like this one here, doesn't actually show that it's using a vacuum. What we see here is you have, in the center, there's a boiler, and you have the fire under the boiler. You have two chambers on both sides, and these alternately fill. So this will fill with water while this one pumps. When this is pumped dry, you switch the center valve. Now this one fills up and this one pumps. And you keep alternating sides, one after the other, bringing water in to one and pumping the other. It's not a simple system. It's a lot of valves involved there. And you have to get the water into those two balls, which means that they actually have to be, those two pumping chambers have to be below the height of the water source. And it's just not a convenient thing to do by any means. It was not generally considered successful. You have to bring all your fuel down into the mine. You have to burn all the fuel in the mine. You then have to get all the smoke out of the mine, which is always a major problem with a mine. Water, of course, isn't an issue. You've got more water you know what to do with. That's why you're pumping it in the first place. So the boiler technology, again, was very young. It could maintain low pressures. If you were trying to pump this at about 15 PSI, that would also give you about a 30-foot lift. So probably what it was doing is using that 30 feet to push steam into the top and push water back out through a central pipe up to the top. And it could go about 30 feet. So the goal of this pump was actually to drain silver mines in Guadalcanal, Spain. There were silver mines that were very profitable, very high yield, and they flooded. This is a very common problem in mining, and actually a source of some really great engineering. Newcomen built his pumps to deal with mine flooding. Watt built his pumps, his first engines, to deal with mine flooding. These were built to deal with mine flooding. There's some incredible technology out there. There's giant water wheels that are like underground in mines. It's just like chains of wheels underground that lifted the water up. Just great technology. I hope to get over there and film these someday. But the goal was to pump water out of the mines, and it just really wasn't that efficient, unfortunately. It took a lot of work. It was hard to deal with the maintaining a fire below the flooded water level in the mine. Of course, you could bring the boiler up some, but the longer your pipe, the more you lose of your steam. So it was not a great solution. But was it steam-powered? Yeah, you could probably say it was steam-powered. Was it an engine? You know, that one's a little trickier than with Hero's engine. And the reason it's a little trickier, it certainly acted on water. It took an external thing, water, and moved it someplace you didn't want it. But did it mechanically do that, or was it more through just, you know, pressures and things? So is it more really a steam pump rather than a steam engine? And I'd really call it a steam pump.
So Newcomen built his first atmospheric engines in 1712. The only input to his atmospheric engines was steam. He had a boiler, generated steam, a pipe into the engine. There was no other energy input. There's no other fuel input to it. So clearly it was in fact steam powered, because there was nothing else going in. So it had to be steam powered. It was also an atmospheric engine because the power stroke was actually provided through the use of atmospheric pressure. You would create that vacuum which pulls the piston down. So that creates atmospheric pressure. It creates your power stroke, so it's an atmospheric engine. So remember that magical process that we talked about where you put gasoline in, magic happens, and then the drive shaft turns? Well, let's look a little bit deeper at that magical process. So you put gasoline in, and then you get the first of four cycles in the engine called combustion. Combustion is the fuel and the air actually exploding, and that creates your power cycle. That's the power from the engine. Everything else is just recovery. After you have the combustion phase, then you have the exhaust phase, and then you have the intake phase where you bring in more fuel, and you have the compression phase. Those last three phases are all about recovery, getting ready for the next combustion phase, and then you combust again. So this is a gasoline-powered engine. It's also an internal combustion engine. Internal combustion because that combustion actually happens inside that engine. That's compared to external combustion, which is steam engines. Steam engines, the combustion happens outside under the boiler. So this is both a gasoline engine and an internal combustion engine. So keeping that in mind, that this is both of those aren't mutually exclusive. The same is true of steam engines and atmospheric engines. So Newcomen Watt engines are steam engines, and Newcomen and Watt and many other manufacturer engines are also atmospheric engines. Steam and atmospheric engines are not, in fact, mutually exclusive terms. All atmospheric engines are steam engines. Not all steam engines are atmospheric engines. So this is the largest steam engine here at Henry Ford Museum. This is Ford Motor Company's 1916 Highland Park steam generator. It's a two-cylinder engine. Here you have one cylinder over here. You can see these things are absolutely huge. In fact, I'm standing on the second story of this engine. This is a huge steam engine. It is entirely steam powered. It is not an atmospheric engine. It's much larger, much higher pressure than the other steam engines that we've looked at previously, but it is in fact still a steam engine. It is not an atmospheric engine. It does not draw vacuum anywhere as a power source. Watt and Newcomen engines are steam engines and atmospheric engines, and for that matter, they're external combustion engines as well. Steam engines are still surprisingly common out there. A lot of people think that this is technology that's long gone. but a lot of large ships, freighters and stuff, still use steam power today. Most of our electricity comes from steam power. Coal power plants, natural gas, nuclear plants, nuclear submarines, those are all steam power. Even some of the bigger solar power plants, the ones that have like the fields full of mirrors that reflect up onto a tower, those are actually steam power. So steam is definitely still with us today. Steam engines are still with us today. The pistons here have mostly been replaced with turbines, but other than that, the technology is pretty similar. And really, no matter what the technology is, from Heron's aeolipile up to huge engines like this, this is steam power, and this is the Industrial Revolution. Hey, before you go, I do need your help to keep this channel going, and also to help keep it growing. Easiest thing you do to help is just to click the like button. Also, if you can do subscribe and notify, then you'll know when I release new videos and you'll be able to watch those. Also, I have a Patreon page over at patreon.com/industrialrevolution. And if you have any questions, comments, places you think I should go visit, please leave those down in the comments section of the video. That's actually the best way to tell YouTube, hey, this is a channel worth watching. Thanks for watching, and I look forward to seeing you at the next one.